You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Good afternoon, and welcome to Gardens of California. My name is Jerry Turney, and I'm your host and instructor. I guess my official name is Gerald Turney, but everyone calls me Jerry. If you haven't watched the class before, this is a live broadcast, and you can call in about your garden, any questions about your garden. My background is that I have a bachelor's in botany and a graduate degree in plant pathology, and I've spent almost 40 years now, actually more than 40 years, working in the landscape maintenance industry, either as a tree trimmer. I used to be a landscape contractor and a tree trimmer. Then went back to school, got my degrees, worked at the Huntington Botanical Gardens, worked at the Los Angeles County Arboretum. And now for the last 15 years, I've been the plant pathologist for the Los Angeles County Agricultural Commissioner, where I run a plant diagnostic laboratory. So I get samples in, I tell people what's wrong with their plants, and I give them advice on how to control it. But I'm also a certified arborist, so I tell people how to take care of their trees. And I have a pest control advisor's license, so I tell people how to take care of their pests. And today, we are going to talk about integrated pest management. Last Sunday, we talked about insects. We talked about all the kinds of insects that can affect your garden. But if you have a question about an insect in your garden or any problem in your garden, call in, because we'd love to hear from you. Our number is 1-800-339-1193. You can also email in questions if you'd like, and that will come up on the screen momentarily. Here it is, askdhtvlive@gmail.com. So go ahead and email us your question, and if you want, attach a picture of your garden. We'll bring it up on the screen. We'll talk about your garden, talk about your tree, whatever you want to talk about. Give us a call. I'd love to hear from you. Now, we always like to start the show with upcoming events. If you are a student enrolled in the class, you need to attend one outside event and write an essay about it, telling us what you learned, or telling me what you learned about plant care or plant family or plants in general. So you could go to any kind of meeting, a garden club meeting, a plant society meeting, a class at one of the botanical gardens, a tour of a garden, and just tell me what you learned about it. Just the whole purpose of this is just to go out, actually enjoy yourself, and learn something new about plants and gardens. That's what this show is all about. So let's take a look at our upcoming events that you can put on your calendar. The Shakespeare Lovers in the Garden is coming up at Descanso Gardens on February 14th from 1:30 to 3:30 p.m. Descanso Gardens is a wonderful garden to walk around. The camellias are in full bloom there right now. Give them a call at 818-949-4200, and they can tell you more about that, and go on their website and look at their calendar, and they have lots of classes as well. In addition to that, we have the Camellia Crafts, also at Descanso Gardens on February 28th from 10 to 1. Like I said, Descanso is famous for their camellia garden, and they have a lot of camellia flower shows at Descanso, put on by the Southern California Camellia Society. And they also do a lot of fun stuff with camellias. So that's another fun thing to do at Descanso. So I think that's it for our upcoming events. But if you know, it's a beautiful day out today, a warm day. Too bad it's not raining, because we desperately need some rain. We've gotten a little bit so far this season, but not nearly enough. So, and now we also like to have a mystery plant. So let's take a look at our mystery plant. If you recognize this plant, give us a call. Let's go to the overhead, because it's kind of a small plant. It's a little succulent. I grow quite a few small succulents. They're a lot of fun. So here it is. If you recognize the genus, go ahead and give us a call. I'll tell you a little bit about it. This is one of a group that we refer to as window plants. They may be related to each other, they may not be all that related to each other, but they have all adapted this characteristic that allows them to grow in dry environments. The lines here, the dark areas you see, are actually clear areas that allow the light to penetrate the leaf and illuminate the interior of the leaf. So there are a number of plants that do this, small succulents, and you can see this is quite firm and hard. I don't know if you can see how, you know, it's really kind of tough. And inside is actually kind of thick and filled with a gelatinous material. And when the light penetrates through these openings or these dark areas, it illuminates the interior of the leaf, and then it reduces the surface area, but it still allows the leaf to be photosynthetic and produce food. And of course, plants like this typically grow rather slowly. And this is one that would do quite well in a bowl, but I don't want to give away everything. If you recognize it, give us a call and take a guess at what it is. I'm just going to set it over here. Well, let me put it where you guys can still see it. Now, I got a couple things that are blooming. Before we move on and talk more about the insects, I've got a couple plants that are blooming, and I just wanted to share them with you. I grow a handful of different kinds of orchids. This, of course, is a cymbidium orchid, and I've got two spikes on it. And it's just a, you know, they're blooming right now this time of year. This is when they start blooming, really. This one was probably repotted about a year ago, maybe 2 years ago. I repot mine about every 3 years. Some people repot every 2 years. And if you can zoom in on the leaf, on the flower, you know, this is really pretty one. So this is a cymbidium orchid. You can grow these outdoors. In a cold winter, you might get some, if we get down into the 20s, you're going to get some damage. It'll freeze off the flowers for sure. And it'll freeze some of the leaves, but it won't kill it. Cymbidiums can be grown outdoors in Southern California. Quite easily along the coast, of course. Maybe a little more difficult if you're in an area where it actually freezes on a more regular basis. So you couldn't grow these outdoors at Big Bear or up in the mountains. And so this is a really pretty one. I don't have the name of the cultivated variety. I've got quite a few that I collected over the years, and I divided them a lot, but I'm trying to actually reduce my collection. So this is a cymbidium. They get watered about, once a week or so in the spring, and then about twice a week in the summer. And then you want to fertilize them, and they need bright shade. They cannot take the full sun in the afternoon, they'll burn. And they can't take deep shade or they won't bloom. You want the foliage to be kind of a light green or a yellowish green, indicating it's getting enough light. I keep mine under shade cloth, and they do pretty well that way. They can take morning sun, but then they need the afternoon shade. And you have to grow them in an orchid bark, and particularly I would grow them in a cymbidium mix, not which is a little heavier mix than you would use for something like a Cattleya or a Phalaenopsis. And then the other one that's blooming is a bromeliad that I've got here. And I may, you know, I bring them in when they're blooming because they may not be blooming when I talk about that plant group. So this one's really kind of pretty. It's got three flower spikes coming out. And I like bromeliads. They're so easy to grow. You just keep a little water in the cup. They form a cup. All these leaves are really cups. And this one's really starting to take off. And I think this, you know, this was one that was given to me by somebody at some point in time. I don't remember who. And I didn't have the name of it then. I should take it down to Rainforest Flora, show it to them, and they'll tell me what species it is, the genus and species. It may be Belbergia. But I'm not sure it's Belbergia. I may try and figure this out and tell you. But this is a bromeliad, and it's in bloom. So I just wanted to share that with you, the couple things blooming in my garden. And now let's talk a little bit about books, and then we'll take a look at all these samples I have in front of me. Last week I talked about insects, and this is probably your best book for insects. If you are a gardener and you want to know a little bit more about the insects that are eating your plants, or if you just want interested in entomology, this is one of your better books to start with. It's Insects of the Los Angeles Basin by Hoag. Hoag was the curator of entomology at the Natural History Museum. So Insects of the Los Angeles Basin probably could use an update because there's a lot of new introduced species. But it shows you the insects, and it gives you a description over here of the insects, and it shows you pictures of the life stages. Here you've got the mealybug, which we talked about last week, and let's see which one that is. Just real quick, just interested. This is the long-tailed mealybug. I actually showed you a picture of it last week. And what do they say about it? Soft scales, brown soft scales, mealybugs. Mealybugs related to unarmored scale insects. And let's see, long-tailed mealybug. It probably discusses it on the next page. But and I'm going to show you more insects that are long-tailed mealybugs. This species is distinguished by its very long terminal filaments. These are usually as long or longer than the body. Conspicuous filaments around the edge of the body, diffuse stripe down the middle of the back. But, you know, mealybugs are real common. But anyway, so this is a really excellent book. You can get it at the Natural History Museum downtown, or you can order it online, I'm sure. Really excellent book, not very expensive. A really excellent book. And part of IPM, we're going to talk about integrated pest management today. One of those central tenets of IPM is recognizing your pest. And so that's the kind of book you need to do that. But let's look at some other books. This is Diseases in Trees of Shrubs. This is a fairly expensive book, one that most gardeners aren't going to want to purchase because it's probably at least $150, maybe even more. And it's edited by Sinclair, Lyon, and Johnson. It's really an excellent book. And you can see all this stuff in here marks different pages on different diseases that I've marked. I often refer to this book when I want to refresh myself on the details of various diseases of trees and shrubs. And so you can look in here and read about oak root rot fungus. You can read about rust diseases on trees. It's really a pretty thick book. You can see how big it is, and it's excellent. And there are copies at the Los Angeles County Arboretum that you can go in and look at and read and look up a section and photocopy that section if you want, and then have it as part of your library for your garden library. So it covers, leaf spot diseases on trees, rust diseases on trees, root rots, everything you can think of that's a disease. It's really an excellent, excellent book, one of the better ones. And let me just, there is a companion text, also by Johnson and Lyon, Insects That Feed on Trees and Shrubs. And this is really another excellent book. And you can come in here and read about pine bark beetles. You can read about, aphids or, the pine aphid or whatever it is you want to read about. When it comes to insects that feed on trees and shrubs, it's going to almost certainly be in here. So this is really an excellent, excellent text on insects and a companion book to diseases of trees and shrubs. And then this is the newest book, and I just got it yesterday, and I haven't even had a chance to really look at it, but I know it's going to be an excellent book. I gave a talk yesterday to the San Bernardino County Master Gardener Training Program, and as a token of their appreciation, they gave me a copy of the California Master Gardener Handbook. This is published by the University of California, and it's quite a thick book and probably covers just about everything you ever want to cover when talking about gardens and master gardening. Dennis Pittenger is the editor, and I know Dennis. I used to play basketball with Dennis at UCR. It has, water management, soil and fertilizer management, water management, plant propagation, plant pathology, insects, weeds, safe and sustainable pest management, house plants, lawns, woody landscape, home vegetable gardening, grapes, berries, temperate tree fruit and nut crops, citrus, avocados, landscape and garden design, poisonous plants, and diagnosing plant problems. So it looks like a pretty thorough text. I haven't read it, but it looks like it'd be a really excellent book for any home gardener. I'm not sure what they charge for it. They probably give it to the Master Gardener trainers. Anyway, so this is the California Master Gardener Handbook. Really, really another wonderful text to have in your garden, your garden library. The University of California also has a series of books that are called Integrated Pest Management Guides, and they are usually specific to a crop. This one is the Integrated Pest Management Guide for Citrus, and this covers every problem that occurs on citrus in California. So it includes all the insects, It'll probably talk about, you know, certainly all the diseases that you can get on citrus, phytophthora root rot, or the fruit diseases. Let's just take a look real quick and look at the table of contents. I refer to this one actually quite frequently. Here's your table of contents: managing pests in citrus, vertebrate pests, insects, mites, and snails. So it talks about scale insects, thrips, orange worms, mites, ants, katydids, mealybugs, whiteflies, diseases, root rots, fruit rots, and then it talks about nematodes and weeds. And usually they also have a section on kind of, it has the citrus tree development and growth requirements. So it talks, you know, it's really excellent publication on citrus. So if you're big into citrus, these run around $35. You can order them from the University of California online. And there are about 35 of these actually for different crops. So there's an IPM guide for strawberry production, IPM guide for corn, which most of you don't need. But the other one that's kind of nice is, and a little bigger, is the integrated pest management guide for stone fruits. And this is peaches, nectarines, plums, apricots, cherries, and this is a little thicker because stone fruits have more problems. There's chapters on growth and development, managing pests, insects and mites, diseases, nematodes, vegetation management, and vertebrate pests. So one of the most devastating when you grow peaches, of course, is the oriental fruit moth, and you get the grubs or the larva all the way to the center of the fruit, and it ruins the fruit. And you can literally have every peach on your tree have this. People say it's got worms. It's not really a worm. It's a larva for a moth. And actually, you can see the moth behind me. That is the oriental fruit moth, a little grayish moth that you'll never see unless you're out in the middle of the night, because moths fly at night. But it gives you the biology, and it's an integrated pest management guide. And we're talking about IPM today. Now, the other book that I always talk about is our Western Garden book, which is the text for our class. And this is an encyclopedia of plants, plus it's got some wonderful sections at the beginning on plant uses. It's got sections on pest control and how to, all sorts of things about gardening. So this is really one of the very first books you should buy if you want to have some books on gardening. And then, of course, just kind of a fun book, because I have way too many books, by the way. The Great Chili Book. You know, I'm a big fan of peppers and chilies. And one season I grew 15 different varieties of chilies, but usually I'll only grow a couple. But I'm thinking this next spring, you know, in March, I'm going to try and grow a bunch more. But what's really nice is this goes through and talks about all these different chilies. And so maybe what I'll do is I'll take this book, make a list of all these different chilies. This is habanero. This got to be habanero. It is habanero. I've never grown habanero. It's one of the hottest of all the chilies. I just don't. But anyway, the Great Chili Book, kind of fun book by Harrison and Frank. It talks about all the varieties. And actually, when you have, when you're gardening, you know, the varieties become so important to you because you want to grow something very specific. If you just go, oh, I'm going to grow peppers. Well, what kind of pepper? There's hundreds of different kinds of peppers. You can grow bell peppers, cayenne peppers, the Anaheim peppers, habaneros, poblano. There's so many. So you get a book like that. Look through it, read about them, and select a variety you want to grow, or several varieties you might want to grow. And actually, now's the time, if you want to grow from seed, now's the time, a very good time, to plant your seeds for your summer vegetable garden. If you want to get an early start and get everything out by March 15th, you could start seed now in small pots, like 4-inch pots, and they'll be ready to transplant out March 15th. You have to be very careful with peppers, not to put them out too early. If we have cold nights, it can really hurt them. Now, tomatoes, not so much. So that's our book parade. Let's take a look at our samples, because, you know, it's really important to recognize some of these. Now, this is Algerian ivy that grows in my backyard, and it is always covered with scale insects. Scale insects are one of the more difficult insects to control because they secrete a covering over themselves that protects them from the environment. It also protects them from pesticides, insecticides. So if you spray them with soaps and oils, You'll kill any juveniles that are walking around, the crawler stage, but you won't affect the adult stage. You'll need to use something more potent to kill scales if you have a heavy scale infestation on a particular tree or plant material in your garden. You're almost forced at some point to use a broad-spectrum insecticide. But let's go to the overhead and you can see what this looks like. And, okay, you see how it's just covered with all these dots. And the thing about scale insects is they scrape off. If you just scrape it with your finger, you're going to get them all over your finger. And so they come right off, but these are scale insects. They're just little tiny things that are stuck to the leaf. A lot of them may be dead already. One of the things you're going to notice when you have a heavy scale infestation on a leaf is you're going to get this black sooty mold, and it's right here. I don't know if you can see it well, but when I wipe it, it comes right up, and then I've got this black all over my finger. And that's sooty mold. Sooty mold is a fungus that will grow, usually not one particular species of fungus, in almost any of these fungi that grow in sweet honeydew dripped off the insects will be black. And this one was really quite dramatic in how much sooty mold is on it. It's just covered with it. So this is ivy, and it often has this scale. And I don't know which scale this is. I haven't actually bothered to have it identified to species. I'm sure it's a common one that's all over the place. Now, this may get on some other plants in my garden. It may not, depending on its host range. That's where knowing the species would be very helpful. And in fact, if you were really diligent, that's what you would do, is you would send it in to our laboratories at the Los Angeles County Agricultural Commissioner's Office, send in the leaf to insect identification, and then you'll get a call, or then we'll tell you what it is. And then we'll tell you how difficult it is to control it. But that's scale on Algerian ivy. And let's take a look. This is another common problem that a lot of people call me about. And we'll talk about this more in depth, we'll just talk about it again when we talk about citrus later in the season, or later during the class. But this is citrus leaf miner, and you'll notice these leaves are twisted and contorted. Yeah, that's good. You can see how twisted and contorted they are. And you can also notice that there's this serpentine pattern or snake-like pattern in the leaf. And it kind of looks almost clear as well. And this is a moth. It's called the citrus leaf miner. And the moth, a very tiny little gray moth, and it lays its eggs and then they hatch. I think this one actually shows it. Oh, there you go. There's the citrus leaf miner. But if we take here, you can see clearly this patterns in the leaf. The moth is quite tiny, and the caterpillar is even smaller. And it lays its egg on the leaf, it hatches, and the caterpillar burrows into the leaf and then feeds inside the leaf, traveling around, feeding in the leaf until it gets a little bigger and a little bigger. Finally, it comes to the end and it pupates and then flies off as a little tiny moth. So you can get pretty heavy infestation. If you look at this branch, every leaf on it is infested with the citrus leaf miner. Or I should say it's been damaged by the citrus leaf miner, because the miners are gone. They are off overwintering as adults. This is an interesting leaf miner. It doesn't really become active in the early spring, March, April, or May. But by June, you're going to start to see the moths in flight. By July, you're going to start seeing the damage. So your first sprays for this would start in mid-June. And what usually works the best is spinosad, and we'll talk a little bit more about spinosad. Spinosad is for chewing insects, for beetles, grasshoppers, caterpillars, and leaf miners, and this is a leaf miner. So that's citrus leaf miner. This here is interesting because, I pruned down my roses, and they're starting to grow back really nicely. And I was looking at the growth today, and I was saying, well, is there anything going on? Usually with this soft, tender new growth, let's go to the overhead and take a look at this. These leaves are brand new. They're dark purple red. They're going to turn green as they expand and mature. But right now they're quite soft and tender. And if you flip it over on the back side, you can start to see the very first aphids of spring, even though it's winter. If it were colder, you probably wouldn't see it, but it's been very warm lately. Here's a little aphid right there on the edge of that leaf. I don't know if you can see it. They're quite small. But, you know, this is what IPM is all about, is inspecting your plants, finding the insects early, before they do their damage, before there are millions of them. Here, there's just one little aphid crawling right there, and there's really very few aphids on here. There's probably just, you know, two or three on this. Well, now is a good time probably to hit them with something like soap or oil to knock them back and prevent them from exploding, because these insects, their populations can go through the roof very, very quickly. Now, the next thing to show you is cheeseweed. Now, that's a common weed that grows in gardens, and it's coming up. We've had just enough rain, really, to get a lot of weed growth. If we don't get much rain, you don't get a lot of weeds germinating and coming up. But this is cheeseweed, and if you look at it, you can see it's been chewed on a lot. And that's really an important distinction. When you see this, I would almost guarantee this is probably a caterpillar, but it could have been a beetle. And if you don't find the insect on there, you're kind of guessing what it is. Although if you look up the host, you might get a better idea. But this is cheeseweed, a common weed in the Malvaceae, the Malva family. And so you can see all these are chewed on quite a bit. And that indicates either a caterpillar, perhaps a beetle. It doesn't look too much really like a grasshopper. It looks more like a caterpillar to me. But the caterpillar's gone, probably pupated and turned into an adult and flew off. That's the thing about entomology and insect damage, is often you'll see the damage, but the pest is already gone. And with diseases, you see the damage, and then you have to diagnose it. So it's quite a bit different. Now, this is sow thistle or milkweed. And let's take a look at some of the flowers right here. Let's go to the overhead. And you can see it's already bloomed. This already bloomed, this one here, and it's got all the seed in here. So this head right here is going to produce a bunch of seed. There's probably at least a couple hundred seeds in here. They look a little immature, to tell you the truth. I might have gotten a little early, which is what you want to do. If you let this mature, these will float off in the wind, and every one of these will probably germinate, and you're going to get, from this one plant, you're going to get 1,000 more plants. So the key to controlling weeds is getting them before they go to seed. You want to get on them early in the season, like right now. This weekend would be great, or sometime this week. If you've got weeds coming up in your vegetable garden, if you're not growing a winter vegetable garden, if you just got bare dirt where you had your summer vegetable garden last summer, and you're just now starting to think about getting ready for the summer vegetable garden, deal with the weeds now. Don't wait until, you know, the second week of March and go out there and start weeding. And there's some great ways to suppress your weeds. One of it, those little hairs are floating all over the place now, but it's called sheet mulching. I hadn't heard that term until recently, but you put down a barrier, cardboard or brown construction paper is also used. And then you cover that with about 4 inches of compost or wood chip or some organic matter. The cardboard on itself actually will do most of the work, but it looks a lot nicer too, and the mulch is really beneficial and actually increases the efficacy of the practice. And you put down the cardboard, the whole area that where you had your vegetable garden, cover it with the compost, let it sit there all winter, and then when a time in the spring, especially if we've had a little rain and the cardboard rots away and the mulch decomposes, then you just turn it into the soil and you're all ready to go. You can also just dig holes through it and plant through it. It's a great way to kill your lawn. And then just poke holes through the cardboard and the mulch and plant your shrubs or whatever you're going to grow. The other thing to see on here, of course, is powdery mildew. And let's take a look at this leaf and see if you can get a look at it from the overhead. I got all these things floating all over the place. Here we go. You see all this white, fluffy stuff here. And it wipes off pretty easily. But it is actually powdery mildew. Powdery mildew is a fungus. There are a handful of genera that are powdery mildews. There's two names. One name is for this stage, and it's called oidium. But if it goes through sexual reproduction, it would be one of the other genera, one of the perfect stages that fungi have. The thing about powdery mildews is they are usually host specific. So this powdery mildew probably only infects this species or maybe a few others that are closely related. It will not go off and infect your rose bushes. You do get powdery mildew on roses, but it's not this fungus, not this species that's on this plant. It's a different one. The one on roses will actually go to peaches as well, but peaches and roses are fairly closely related. They're both in the rose family, the Rosaceae. So powdery mildews are just right on the surface. And if you get them early, before it gets to this stage where the whole leaf is infected, if you scout your plants and get on it early, then you can control it fairly easily with a variety of products. Some of the oils work, like neem oil and stylet oil are supposed to work. There are probably some soaps that will work as well. And there's also milk and water, and then there's also potassium bicarbonate, which is now, Kellogg Gow is a potassium bicarbonate-based fungicide that works quite well. And those are all non-toxic organic ways to control it. So this is, just wanted to have a comment. You know, you can have a whole IPM strategy for weeds, and it's critical that you suppress weeds in a garden. Otherwise, they take over the garden. Instead of growing what you want to grow, now you're just growing a bunch of things that grow on their own. But let's talk about IPM. And what it means and where it came from, because it has an interesting history. So integrated pest management occurred shortly after World War II with the introduction of broad spectrum of highly effective insecticides that you could literally spray once at the beginning of the season and you'd be done, you'd control insects for the whole season. Stuff like DDT, parathion, highly toxic, and long residuals. And so during the late 40s and the 50s, for relatively low prices, you could protect your crop from insects with just one or two sprays at the beginning of the season. And then it became a problem because these long residual pesticides started showing up in groundwater. They started affecting non-target species, birds or other insects that you don't want to kill. And then people started talking about other ways to control insects rather than just trying to have a silver bullet. Go out there and you have one product, hit it, you're done, you don't have to think about anything. And then the other problem with that was that people would just do it without even looking for the pest. Got a lot of stuff all over everything here. So it was here in California. The concept of supervised insect control was introduced, and now it's called integrated pest management. Although historically focused on insects, it is now extended to almost all aspects of pest control. The U.S. Environmental Protection Agency has a set of IPM principles, and the first principle that they list is to set an action threshold. Now, in agriculture, if you've got a few insects on your crop, it may not reduce your yield. So do you need to spray? The answer is no. The action threshold is the population of the insect at which you're going to have a yield reduction or damage that you need to avoid to your crop. So prior to IPM, if you found one insect in your crop, you went out and sprayed. Well, the new concept was, well, no, that one insect is probably okay. Maybe there's something that'll eat it. Maybe you won't get a huge bloom of and get millions of them. So once or twice a week, or even every day, if you're really right on top of it, then you're going out and you're inspecting your crop, and you're seeing the insects, and you have a threshold. One per leaf may be below the threshold. Two per leaf may be the threshold. So you go out and you examine 100 leaves, and you write down how many times you found the insect pest you're looking for, and then you divide by 100 and you say, oh, I've got 1.3 insects per leaf. I'm below the threshold. I don't need to spray today. But you got to keep monitoring because in a week you may be up to 2. When you hit 2, then you spray. What that does for you is it reduces the amount of pesticide you're using on your crop, reduces the frequency you're spraying because you're not spraying when you don't need to. So it's going to save you money. It's going to reduce the amount of pesticides used in the environment, released into the environment. That's the goal of IPM, is to reduce the amount of toxic pesticides released into the environment and to use the least toxic means to control insect pests. So actually, when you decide you have to do something, then you have to decide what to use. And you always want to reach for the least toxic material first. So if you find a few aphids on your rose bushes, and you know from your experience that in a week, those two or three are going to be 200 or 300, then you reach for the least toxic means to control those aphids. That might be soap or oil or maybe a pyrethrin. And we'll talk about those in a minute. The other principle is monitor and identify pests. We talked about that already. You've got to go through your field a couple times a week. You have your action threshold, you're monitoring. The other really important aspect of pest control, and it transcends IPM a little bit, is regardless of your practicing IPM, the first thing you need to do when you're dealing with a pest is correctly identify the pest. If you think you know what you've got and you're wrong, then you don't know if what you're doing is helping, not doing anything, or making it worse. If it's helping, you're probably okay. If it's not doing anything, you're at least wasting your time and money doing something that doesn't do anything to the pest. I got a great example of that, and I'll tell you in a second. The other is you might apply something that'll actually make the problem worse. So you have to correctly identify your pest. Such as this, on this cheeseweed. It's being chewed on, but you don't know what's chewing on it. So it's probably gone already. So you can't just reach for malathion and spray it thinking that that's gonna work. You can't reach for a product until you know what the pest is. Prevention is another one of the principles of IPM. IPM actually starts before you plant your crop. It starts with the selection of the site, the selection of the cultivar, the actual variety of the plant you're going to grow. Using resistant plant material is always better than trying to come back later and spray it. And in plant diseases, the number one means to control plant diseases is with resistant plant material, not fungicides, not bactericides, not spraying the crop. The number one way you control a plant disease in agriculture, and this should be the same in your backyard too, is by selecting those varieties that are resistant or don't get the disease at all. The next principle of IPM is control. That's where you have to pick a product and decide which one to use. You always want to select the least toxic material that will do the job. If you pick something that won't do the job, and it may be really benign, really good stuff, but it's not going to do the job, you're again wasting your time. So you've got to pick something that's effective, but you always want to pick the least toxic. Now, that's from the US EPA with four principles. There are other people, like if you go to Wikipedia, you'll find that they have, they say instead of an action threshold, it's an acceptable pest level. And that may be more appropriate kind of for a homeowner, is an acceptable pest level. What will you live with? You can have a few holes in your tomatoes as long as you get a lot of tomatoes. That doesn't bother you. You can have a few bugs on your plants as long as you don't have too many. So the emphasis is on control, not eradication. IPM holds that wiping out an entire pest population is often impossible, and that's true. You're not going to eradicate a pest. And the attempt can be more costly, environmentally unsafe, and frequently unachievable. So you have to have acceptable pest levels. That's the same thing as an action threshold. Preventative cultural practices. So selecting varieties, putting down thick layers of compost to suppress weeds, early interdiction with a control when you know a certain pest is always a problem on your crop. Monitoring, we already talked about monitoring, checking your plants on a regular basis. And that's how you know whether you have an acceptable level. They go and they say mechanical controls. The problem is they're starting to talk about actual tactics and not strategies. And when you talk about pest control, there's strategy and there's tactics. If your strategy is avoidance, then you rotate. if you've got root knot nematodes in a field, you don't plant susceptible plants in that field to root knot nematode. You avoid it. You go to a field where there is no root knot nematode, or you plant plants that don't get it, which is actually resistance. So there's mechanical controls and biological controls. There are, of course, beneficial insects. You want to encourage them, and there's a variety of ways you can do that, particularly by using what we call the soft pesticides, not reaching right off the bat for a highly toxic, broad-spectrum material that kills everything, because that can disrupt the biocontrol that's going on for another pest. It's called, some people call it the boomerang effect. You kill the pest you're trying to kill, but you also kill a beneficial insect that's suppressing a different insect. And so after you kill that beneficial, you have a huge problem with that other insect because you killed the beneficials. So that's really important. And then they talk about chemical controls. The problem is these aren't really principles. They've actually gotten below the principle level in this Wikipedia article. So that's kind of the concept of IPM. Let me just further comment that IPM really was developed for insects, because long before people started talking about IPM for insects, plant pathologists were already practicing IPM. They just weren't calling it that. Now they call it IPM. Everyone talks about IPM. But prior to the development of integrated pest management, plant diseases never really had a lot of chemical sprays that would control a disease. That's still quite true today. There's a lot of diseases out there that no one sprays for because it's either economically not feasible, or the product, there just isn't a product that does it. So historically, the way you controlled a plant disease was by developing or breeding for varieties that were resistant. So that's how diseases have been controlled in agricultural production. And so today you can go out and get plants that have resistance to root knot nematode. You can get tomatoes that are highly resistant to root knot nematode. You can get the heirloom varieties that are highly susceptible. You just have to know when and how to use both types of varieties. If you've got root knot, you can either rotate out of that spot and keep growing your heirloom. So if you want to keep growing in that spot, you're going to have to go to a resistant variety. So, and a lot of the conventional or the varieties of tomato that they don't call heirloom, they're not old, they're fairly modern varieties. Early Girl, Better Boy, those have root knot nematode resistance. In fact, if you look at the label, it lists all the things they're resistant to on it. If you look at the label on a tomato tag, if you get a 4-inch tomato or a pony pack of tomatoes at a garden center, there'll be a little tag, and it will say, it might say V, F, FF, N. V is verticillium resistance, F is fusarium race 1 resistance, FF is fusarium race 2 resistance, N is root knot nematode resistance, and it might even have some virus resistance in it, and that would also be indicated on the tag. So those types of plants, you plant them out and you've got less problem with that. Now, that's not the heirloom varieties. Now, personally, I find that any vine-ripened tomato is absolutely fabulous. I love some of the heirlooms too, but I always grow some Early Girls and Better Boys. Those are kind of my standards in my garden. I'll usually have 4 of each, and then I'll grow some heirlooms as well. Sometimes my heirlooms do really well. Sometimes I get a few problems on them. Now, I have a little video clip, Integrated Pest Management Basics. And so let's go to that video clip, because after you hear this, because it'll just kind of reiterate some of the things I've already said, but some good points in this video clip. Let's go to that video clip, and when we come back, we're going to start looking at products, because one of the central parts of pest control is education. You have to know your pest, and you have to know how to control it. Let's look at this video clip.
Hey, if you're growing vegetables, sooner or later, you're going to have problems with pests in your garden. Hi, I'm the bug guy here for the University of Maryland Extension, and today I'm going to talk about an approach for managing the pests on our plants, which we call integrated pest management. The integrated part comes from the fact that we're going to combine many different tactics and approaches to manage these pests. Hey, we're going to use cultural controls, mechanical controls. We're going to use Mother Nature's hit squad. We call that biological control. And when we have to use pesticides, we're going to try to use the ones that are most environmentally responsible. And in this way, we can produce really healthy, safe vegetables to eat. Step number one in putting together an IPM program is to build your knowledge base. Learn about your plants, learn about the proper culture, rates of fertilization. How are you going to make your vegetables most productive? In the case of these beans, this beautiful trellis allowed these guys to grow up and just produce bountiful fruit. The other thing to learn, of course, is the pests that are going to attack these vegetables. In the case of beans, one of the major nemesis are the Mexican bean beetles. So learn about the history of these, learn their damage characteristics, how they're going to affect the plant, and that actually learn what the various life stages of these insects look like. Here's the adult Mexican bean beetle. Once you build your knowledge base, then you're ready for step two in your IPM program. Monitoring is the second step in building an IPM program. Monitoring means the regular inspection of your vegetables, and what we're looking for are symptoms and signs of insect activity. Symptoms are things like the defoliation that Mexican bean beetles are causing. Signs are the insect itself. So right here we can see the eggs of the Mexican bean beetle. Sometimes using a hand lens can really help us see very small insects and their eggs, or even mites that are on leaves. If you monitor often and thoroughly, you can really stay on top of these pests. The third step in building an IPM program is decision making. You've gone out, you've monitored your plants, you detected your pests. Now you have to decide if and when it's time to treat. In the case of this tomato, hey, there are a few aphids on the leaf, but guess what? There are some ladybird beetles eating this thing. I'm not doing anything at all. But in the case of this squash vine, I think I see some squash vine borer in here. A single larvae could kill that vine, so I'm going to have to do something right now. Decision making, that's the third cornerstone in building an IPM program. The fourth step in building your IPM program is intervention. In this case, we're going to use a floating row cover as a preventive tactic to exclude pests. Another preventive technique we can use is the use of kaolin clay. This is applied to the leaves of plants. It makes the plants unfavorable. The bugs simply don't go there to feed. A third intervention tactic is the use of biological control. This is simply using Mother Nature's hit squad, the predators, parasites, and pathogens that naturally occur and can reduce pest populations. When we've exhausted all other tactics, we may choose to use a pesticide to help reduce these populations. What we like to use are compounds that are on EPA's reduced risk list, those that are safe to use in organic gardening. Always read your insecticide label and always be careful when you apply pesticides. The fifth and final component of an IPM program is record keeping. Record keeping is used to simply keep track of what you saw in your garden and when you saw it. This will help you be prepared next year to figure out when you need to intervene. Also keep track of how well your interventions work. In this way, you'll know if a biological control or a certain pesticide that you used actually did the job. Record keeping is the fifth and final component of a sound IPM program. So that's it, gang. Remember your five steps of your IPM program. Build your knowledge base, monitor your plants, make decisions. When you see those bad boys, smack them down, intervene, and finally, keep records of what you found. In this way, you're going to be able to produce a beautiful, bountiful, healthy crop of vegetables.
So, a lot of good advice there. Excellent advice. I just wanted to kind of reemphasize what IPM is. IPM, according to the US EPA, IPM is not a single pest control method, but rather a series of pest management evaluations, decisions, and controls. In practicing IPM, growers who are aware of the potential for pest infestation follow a four-tiered approach. The four steps include, and we talked about it, action threshold, monitoring, prevention, and control. And so these are strategies. They're not tactics. And I really want to emphasize the difference between a strategy and a tactic. Like I said, avoidance, that's a strategy. The tactic is rotation, moving, you know, not growing the same thing in the same spot, which is really important, by the way. So let's take a look at pesticides, because in the end, you're almost certainly going to use something to control the insects. I have some friends who believe that they don't want to put anything on because they're too lazy. And they're proud of that, and they say, we're the laziest gardeners in the world, and if the plants can't make it on their own, we're not going to help them. Oh, well, that's their philosophy, and it's their garden. They can do anything they want. But they may end up with a small pallet of plant materials that they can grow because there's a lot of pests out there that attack a lot of stuff. The first thing you can reach for to control insect pests, particularly the soft-bodied sucking insects. So last week we talked about the sucking insects and the chewing insects. So the sucking insects are the aphids, the mealybugs, scale, thrips, the stink bugs, whitefly, and aphids and whitefly, very common, and the mealybugs, very common, and also mites. Now, mites are not insects. Mites are arachnids. They are like spiders. But there are mites, like spider mites, and they can be particularly damaging. They can devastate your plant material if you let them get out of hand. So all of those are fairly easily controlled with soap. Now, this first one I'm going to show you is safer insecticidal soap. I want to say I'm not endorsing safer insecticidal soap. I'm just showing it to you as an example of a soap product. And I'm going to show you probably another soap product as well. This is safer insecticidal soap. Soaps are non-toxic to mammals. Almost entirely non-toxic, although that might be a little overstatement because if you drank it, it would probably make you a little sick to your stomach. So it's not like, you know, aspirin is also pretty much non-toxic, but if you eat a bottle, it's going to make you sick. So anyway, this is safer insecticidal soap, and you can recognize soap. Sometimes it won't say soap on the label of the product you select at your local garden center. But you'll notice it'll say, you know, the active ingredient right here. And always read the active ingredient on a pesticide you buy. When you go into a garden center and you say, oh, I've got this problem, and somebody helps you out, and they say, oh, use this product. Look at the active ingredient. You don't have to buy the product right there at that second. Write it down. If you've got a smartphone, right there on the spot. Type it in into Google or some search engine, Bing, or whatever search engine you like to use, and find a website that tells you about that active ingredient. Read a little bit about it before you buy the product and decide later, oh, I didn't want to really use something that's more toxic than I like. I want to use something that's less toxic. So, but soaps are extremely low toxicity. The active ingredient here is potassium salts of fatty acids. That's what soap is. Soaps are fatty acids. And they wash the wax covering off of insects, and they actually get into the cells of insects and disrupt their membranes, and they dry up and die. And so there's never resistance to soap like you'd have with the insect insecticides that are enzyme inhibitors. Soaps always work, and they work fairly quickly. But soaps have no residual activity. They are contact insecticides, and a lot of the stuff I'm going to show you this morning are contact insecticides with no residual activity, which means you have to reapply them fairly frequently. And what I often tell people is you have to spray once a week for 3 weeks, especially on like citrus in the spring. The new soft growth, you'll get aphids, you'll get mealybug. You might have the scaler walking around, the crawler stage. If you spray them once thoroughly with soap, and you don't have to buy safer soap, you can just use Dawn or any dishwashing soap. I just buy generic brand dishwashing soap at the grocery store, and I just put like a teaspoon per gallon. I use a hose-in sprayer, and I thoroughly spray the tree, directing the spray to the backs of the leaves, where most of the insects are going to be on the backs of the leaves. That's going to kill 95, maybe even 99% of the insects in the canopy of the tree, of your citrus, your orange tree. But it's not going to kill them all. There's no residual activity. So over the next week, the ones that you didn't kill, the eggs that survived, they hatch, there's new ones, they're laying eggs. But there's very few because you killed most of them a week earlier. You hit them again after 7 days with another soap application. Now you kill 99% of what's in the tree then, but there weren't very many. And then a week later, you hit them again with soap. Now you pretty much eradicated that pest from the orange tree or lemon tree or lime tree or whatever type of citrus or a peach tree or whatever, or your tomatoes. You got to hit them once a week for about 3 weeks when you're using these contact insecticides with no residual activity. So you can use soap, and this is really the first thing you reach for is soap. Works really, really well, and it's not toxic. You don't have to worry about it. Now, always wear gloves, plastic gloves, and never needlessly expose yourself to any pesticide. You may be allergic to it. Everyone else is fine with it. It may do something to your skin that you're not going to appreciate. So you should always avoid any unnecessary contact with any material you use to kill insects. Although soaps are pretty safe. Now, the other thing I always talk about are oils. And there's a bunch of different kinds of oils. Now, the front of the label came off of this. But if you look at the back, it says Ultrafine. This is Sunspray Ultrafine, year-round pesticide oil. Acting ingredient, paraffinic oil, 98.8%. So this is a paraffin oil. And most of the horticultural oils are light chain or short chain paraffin oils. There are other oils, and I'll show you some of those too. And the way oils work, and they're non-toxic to mammals, almost entirely non-toxic, but they are contact insecticides with no residual activity. So again, you have to spray once a week, and you have to repeat the application for several weeks in order to really clean up a shrub or a bush that's infested with whatever type of soft-bodied sucking insect you're dealing with. So this is Sunspray Ultrafine oil. There's also Volk oil. There's neem oil. Now, neem oil also is made from the neem tree and also has some fungicidal activity, and it's used often to control powdery mildews. In addition, it will kill insects. And then there's stylet oil. Stylet oil is a more refined oil, often used in ag production rather than one of these other oils. Stylet oil will also help suppress powdery mildew. Now, when you talk about powdery mildew, you want to get on it right away. As soon as you see it starting, you don't wait. So that's one oil product. And let me just, should have kept a box handy so I could just move them around. I'll just set it over there. Let's look at this one. This is Home and Garden Insect Spray from Green Light, and indoors and outdoors can be used up to day of harvest. So look at the active ingredient, and it's kind of fun to look at it because it says thyme oil, clove oil, and sesame oil. So this is probably not only not toxic, you could probably use it as a salad dressing. Shake well before using. This is in a spray bottle, so you could use this on your house plants indoors. Because house plants often have a big problem with insects. They're protected indoors from predatory insects, things that are going to eat them and hurt them. You don't get the extremes of temperature. You don't get really hot or really cold. And so indoor plants often have a lot of problems with insects. And like my orchids, I have a lot of orchids in my kitchen, in my greenhouse window. Ones that I can't grow outdoors. It gets too cold in the winter for them outdoors, and it's a little too hot in the hottest part of the summer. So those, like Phalaenopsis, I always get mealybugs on them, all the time. And you know what I do is when I'm washing the dishes, I'll just take a little bit of that dishwasher and pour it over the plant, just pour it on the leaves and kill all the mealybugs. And it works great. I don't even have to really buy a product. I just use the soapy water from washing dishes. So, but this is the three different oils. So now we're seeing clove oil, thyme oil, sesame oil, mint oil, in addition to the light chain paraffin oils. And there's a lot of them out there. And they are actually exempt from pesticide registration now too. So those were the oils and the soaps. You know, in the old days, back when I was mowing lawns, a long time ago, just out of high school, and I had some older customers who had been gardening for many decades, and they used to use a tablespoon of kerosene in a gallon of water and a little bit of soap. They'd put in a tablespoon of detergent, like laundry detergent. Now, I would caution you not to use laundry detergent because it's a little harsher than dishwashing soap, and it's not necessary to take that risk. And I have to tell you also about the oils. You cannot use oils when it's over 90 degrees. If it's over 90 degrees, the oils will burn your foliage. So oils are only used when it's less than 90 degrees and mostly in the spring. You can get away with them in the summer if you use them late in the evening on cooler days. But, you know, at this time, we like to go to a station break and remind you, you're watching Dominguez Hills Television broadcast from Carson on the campus of Cal State University Dominguez Hills. So let's go to our station break. And when we come back, we're going to look at some more pesticides and we'll talk about integrated pest management and try and help you out with your garden. If you have any questions, write them down and call us up as soon as we get back. Let's go to our station break.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hi, I'm Kim McNutt, Dean of the College of Extended Education here at Cal State Dominguez Hills. Did you know that in the first three quarters of this year, there were nearly 34,000 permitted production days of filmed content shot on location by crews just like this all around Los Angeles? While the production crew behind me is following safety protocols, that's not always the case. And the further a crew goes outside the 30-mile zone, the greater chance someone will get hurt. CSU Dominguez Hills has the only OSHA Training Institute Education Center in the LA Basin. We offer a certificate program designed for the specific needs of the film and television industry. Make sure your next production is safe. For more information, visit our website, csudh.edu/OSHA. That's csudh.edu/OSHA.
You are to be congratulated on undertaking a sometimes difficult but always rewarding task of earning your college education. You are here and you are in for a great ride. To want to be successful.
Learn more and you will succeed and excel.
Go Toros!
You can be the class of 2018 that changed the world.
You can do that because you're at CSU Dominguez Hills.
At Dominguez Hills, we want you to get better.
Are in control of your destiny.
Do well, go Toros.
Thank you.
Hello, my name is Dave Bader, Director of Education at the Aquarium of the Pacific in Long Beach, California. I'm really excited to be a partner with Cal State Dominguez Hills and DHTV. It gives us an opportunity to reach audiences that are much broader than the audiences that we can reach by visitation just here at the Aquarium of the Pacific.
My name is Kira Mathis. I'm an education specialist at the Aquarium of the Pacific, and I teach here at Cal State University Dominguez Hills the Biology 190 Introduction to Marine Life course. I love teaching this class. We get to partner with the college and come over, and this is really important because we get to bring a dynamic to this course that the aquarium is great at offering. We get to show animals from our local coast, talk to experts, and reach students that maybe have never even been to the ocean before.
Join the Aquarium of the Pacific and learn about marine life. DHTV makes it all possible.
Hello, my name is Leroy Harding. I'm a junior at California State University Dominguez Hills. The reason why I chose this university was for small classes and interactive programs.
Hi, I'm Bruce Betts, Director of Projects for the Planetary Society, and I'm here at Planetary Society headquarters in Pasadena, California, talking to you about the Young Scholars Program and my introduction to Planetary Science and Astronomy class at California State University Dominguez Hills. One of the main things Planetary Society does is educate and inspire the public about space and space exploration.
So science education is the key to our future, not just California. Not just the United States, but the world, and I'm not kidding, because we have enormous problems to solve around the world, and to understand them and to solve them, we're going to need scientists and engineers, and this is what the Planetary Society does, is get people excited about science through space. We try to advance space science and exploration, really, for the betterment of all humankind, and it all adds up. So Cal State Dominguez Hills is part of that.
I've been a guest at the Cal State Dominguez Hills distance learning classes and been able to talk about my research on Venus and Mars, but also on all of the really cool research that's being done on planets all over the solar system by the active missions that are out there right now. I think that it's really fun to be able to share the adventure of exploring the solar system with audience, with all different kinds of people coming from all different places, whether they're adults or kids, current students, or people who were last students a long time ago.
In the case of this class, to be able to actually not only reach out to new audiences, but provide detail information and really share what is an inherently visual type of science, planetary science, with TV.
At Cal State Dominguez Hills, like at any university, our primary mission is to educate students. Through the Young Scholars Program, we at CSUDH are partnering with the Planetary Society to get high school students from around the state of California interested in science and careers in science even before they enter college. In so doing, we stay involved with our local community and make opportunities available to these students that they might not otherwise get.
So Cal State Dominguez Hills is part of that.
Hello, I'm J. Kim McNutt, Dean of the College of Extended and International Education here at Cal State Dominguez Hills. I want to personally thank you for tuning in to our high-quality educational programming. Remember, watch, listen, learn, DHTV.
Tune in to DHTV on Tuesday nights at 9 p.m. for Jazz in the Modern Era with Chet Hanley, the only live interactive jazz program on cable television in Southern California. If you like jazz, you'll love Jazz in the Modern Era.
Six. amazing.
This is good. I think they rose to the occasion.
Dude, love. Brother, love. That Mandarin sauce is ridiculous. The heat was fantastic. I enjoyed the flavors.
Our champion is the literal.
You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Welcome back. This is Gardens of California, and I'm your host and instructor, Gerald Turney. And today we're talking about integrated pest management. Last week we talked about insects and the various kinds of insects that can affect your garden. And there's lots of them, but I kind of simplified it by talking about sucking insects and chewing insects. There's also wood-boring insects that can be a problem on your trees. So there's all sorts of insects out there. But we looked at some products already. We looked at oils, we looked at soaps. They're non-toxic, very effective. Be careful with the oils. When it's a hot day, you'll burn your foliage with it. Let's talk about another really wholly non-toxic insecticide, that is used to kill caterpillars. Now, caterpillars are one of the major agricultural pest groups. It's not the adults, obviously. It's not the moths. Caterpillars are the destructive part of the insect. They're the ones that chew on all the leaves, and the moths themselves just fly around. There's some butterflies, their larvae or their caterpillars can also feed on plants, but they tend not to be the big problem that moths are. Moths tend to be really serious pests, and butterflies, you don't want to kill all the butterflies. But anyway, let's talk about how to kill caterpillars. Say you've got tomato hornworm or tobacco hornworm on your tomatoes, or you just notice caterpillars are chewing up the leaves of your plant and you don't even see the caterpillars. Maybe they've pupated and flown off and they're very tiny and you don't get to see them. So this particular one is from Safer, Caterpillar Killer, but the active ingredient is Bacillus thuringiensis at 12.7%. Bacillus thuringiensis is a bacteria. It kills caterpillars when they eat it, but it is wholly non-toxic to mammals. This is organically registered, used in organic food production, and you spray it on the plants. The caterpillars eat it, stop eating immediately, and then die within a day or two. Very effective for caterpillars, and the most common caterpillar you might think of course, are the tomato hornworm and tobacco hornworm that are very similar. They're the big green caterpillars with white stripes on them that you see on tomato plants, and a large one can defoliate a tomato plant. Here we see one of the hornworms behind me. And I think that's the tomato. Although, I always get them confused. One has a V-shape chevron, and one has just a single stripe. So there's two different hornworms, tobacco and tomato hornworms. And this controls it quite easily. This is called BT, or Bacillus thuringiensis. And here's the other one, and I believe that's tobacco. BT, non-toxic. It'll have a residual activity because you spray it on the plant, it'll be there for a while, and it'll control the caterpillars. Now, I'm not sure how often you need to spray. I probably need to look into that and read about it. But it probably lasts for some period of time. Maybe you would spray a couple times a month or something like that. I see we have a phone call, so let's go to our first caller. Terry, you're on the air.
Yeah, I have a question. I have a rose bush that gets a lot of bugs on it, and I just don't know what to do with it. I mean, it's just like happens every year on this rose bush.
Okay, well, most likely they're aphids. That's the most common insect you see on roses. You can also see some others. Usually they're all the soft-bodied sucking insects. And the products we've been talking about this morning are very effective. You can just use soap. You can use dishwashing soap. I use it at about a teaspoon to a gallon. It might work even less than that, but that's not very much. You can use this one right here. This is safer insecticidal soap. You could use, there's other soap products. You can use one of the oil products. I think for rose care, for most of the insects that affect roses, you can get complete control, very satisfactory control, with soaps and oils. You can also just, and I didn't mention this earlier in the show, you can also just wash them off with a strong spray of water. Once you wash off sucking insects off of a plant, it breaks their mouth part. You know, they're sitting there feeding on the plant with their proboscis stuck in the leaf. You hit them with water, and that will knock them right off. When it knocks it off, it breaks their mouth. Then they'll never feed again. So actually washing insects off with a strong spray of water is very effective. That the oils and soaps are a little more effective. You need to repeat your sprays once a week for about 3 weeks.
Well, I was wondering, too, if it's just the health of my rose bush. I mean, it doesn't, you know, it seems like it gets illness. I mean, it seems like it insects attack it a lot, and it just doesn't look healthy.
How much sun does it get? Does it get full day sun?
No, maybe it doesn't get a full day sun. Yeah.
You know, roses really require full sun most of the day. The white roses can probably do okay with 6 hours of full sun. But the other roses really need closer to 10 hours or even 12 hours of full sun. If you put roses where they only get sun briefly in the morning, or they don't get full sun at all, they will be leggy, they'll have soft growth, they won't bloom very much, they will not perform well in the landscape. So that's kind of a central element of growing full sun plants or shade plants. Full sun materials, you know, all your vegetables, all the fruit trees, roses, they need about 10 to 12 hours of full sun a day. If you have plants you want them to flower, they need a lot of light. Now, other plants can take morning sun, but they'll need afternoon shade because they'll burn in the full sun in the afternoon. Like the Cymbidium orchid I showed earlier, it cannot take the afternoon full sun. It's interesting, though, about roses. Out in Palm Springs, they actually grow them under shade cloth, but they're getting up to 110, 115 degrees in August. And if you have your roses out in the full sun when it's that hot, it will burn them. But in most of Southern California, in the valleys, along the coast, full sun all day, and then your roses will do best. If it hasn't performed well for you and it's not getting full sun, you might consider you might have to just remove it and plant a different type of plant material that's more appropriate for that location.
Okay. Well, I may have to do that. It sounds like I'm going to have to get a different plant.
Yeah, they really need full sun all day, or they just don't do well. The white ones, though, will do okay at about 6 to 8 hours a day. So they'll do okay with morning sun and afternoon shade if you have a white variety. But the reds and the yellows, they really need, especially the reds, they need full sun all day.
Oh, okay. Yeah, okay. The yellow rose. Okay, well, thank you. Thank you for your information. I appreciate your show. Okay, bye.
Okay, well, thank you for calling, and thank you for watching the show. Let's move on to, do we have another caller? Or is that it? So, if you have a question about your garden, please give us a call at 800-339-1193, or you can email us a question as well, and I believe that's at askdhtv@gmail.com. So let's take a look at some more products and see what else we have on our list of products to control pests in the garden. Okay, There are a group of insecticides that are made from chrysanthemum that are called pyrethrins. Pyrethrins are also organically registered. This one right here is Easy Gone Multipurpose Yard and Garden Insect Killer. I'm going to turn it around and show it to you. And again, the active ingredient is down here. It's right here. And it says that it is permethrin 2.5%, inert ingredients 97.5%. So pyrethrins are a little more effective. They are a little more, and they're not 100% non-toxic like oils and soaps. So this is a little more toxic, not much, but it is organically registered because it comes from a natural source. And if you use this, I would combine it with an oil if it's not on a hot sunny, if it's not hot, if it's not over 90 degrees, because oils are added as a spreader thicker. Plus, they have their own activity of killing insects by smothering them. That's how oils work. Oils smother insects and prevent them from breathing. That's how oils kill insects. But if you add oil to a pyrethrin, and this would be more appropriate for a more difficult pest to control, something like scale insects, because they're just a little, or whitefly. Those two are more difficult, far more difficult than aphids and mealybugs. This may be more appropriate for thrips. There is a flower thrip that really wrecks roses. And they're down in the flowers. And if you start pulling apart the flower and you see these little tiny, long, skinny insects down at the in the flowers, and your flowers are all contorted and twisted, they're not opening properly, you know, they're just damaged and they don't look right. Often that is Western flower thrips. And this would be a little more effective at killing those because they're down and they're hidden, and it's harder to get the material down, and this would be more effective. So this is a pyrethrin. There are also pyrethroids. Pyrethroids are synthetic pyrethrins, and they usually are not organically labeled. Things like onyx, which is bifenthrin, very effective at controlling insects, but not technically organic. So it all depends on how strict you are about being organic. Now let's take a look at this one. What is this one? This is Monterey Garden Insect Spray, and this is spinosad. Let's talk about spinosad, because all these other things we talked about were for sucking insects. And this is spinosad. And spinosad is made from a soil actinomycete. Actinomycetes are bacteria that live in the soil, and they're a special group of bacteria. This particular one was discovered in a rum distillery in the Caribbean once. They went back, never found it again, but they had it. Now they get the actinomycete makes a compound that kills insects when they eat it. So this is really good for chewing insects, for grasshoppers, beetles, caterpillars, and leaf miners. This is what you use most effectively for citrus leaf miner. But it will work really well also for caterpillars. You can use BT for caterpillars, but you can also use spinosad. But spinosad has a 10-day residual. So if you have a beetle problem, if you notice on your bean plants that it's being skeletonized, and that's what you saw in that video clip, that the beetles are rasping at the back of it and leaving the veins, but taking the leafy material away. That's called skeletonizing the leaf. Then if you spray with spinosad, it will control for 10 days. So I kind of generally recommend you spray it about twice a month. You could spray three times a month, but it's probably not necessary to do that. But if you've got a beetle problem, if you've got grasshoppers usually don't do that much damage because there's usually not very many of them. The thing about chewing insects is they're usually highly mobile. They come in today, chew on your plant and fly off and go chew on another plant in your neighbor's yard. And so they come and go. So if you spray a plant for chewing insects with oils and soaps, you might kill the ones that are in the plant right now. But they have no residual activity. So tomorrow, more beetles can fly in, land on the plant, start feeding on the plant, and they don't care that you sprayed it with oil yesterday. But if you spray it with spinosad, it will control them for 10 days. And you can do this up to three times a month, but twice a month is probably sufficient. So that's spinosad, organically registered for chewing insects and leaf miners. Now let's take a look at a couple other things. This is diazinon. Now, diazinon is no longer for sale. It was very commonly used extensively. Diazinon is a broad spectrum insecticide that it is a cholerostorase inhibitor. It's an enzyme inhibitor. It kills insects very efficiently and mites very, very well. So it's really effective, but it was withdrawn from the market. It is no longer sold. You might have a bottle of this in your garage, like I do. I've got a little bit here, not much. And this is, if you had a really bad scale insect on your citrus and you just couldn't get it under control, you spray once with this and you'll get rid of all the scale. This is what you reach for last. The, you know, now diazinon itself wasn't that bad a product, but there were problems with it. One of the problems, it was used extensively for turf. So you'd spray parks, you know, gardens, football fields, or you'd spray, parkland or a cemetery or something like that with lots of turf. And then within a very short time, a flock of birds would land where you sprayed and they would get a dose of it. And it's pretty toxic to birds. So there were some bird kills with diazinon and that gave it a bad rap. And it is a broad spectrum insecticide. It is one of the cholerostorase inhibitors, which is part of your nervous system. It's kind of a nerve toxin. So it got withdrawn. It's no longer sold to homeowners. It used to be, first it was banned for interior use, then it was banned for garden use in homes. It still has a very limited label for ag production, but very limited. And you might have some of this sitting around. I see we have a phone call, so let's go to our next caller. Gordon, calling from Los Angeles. You're on the air.
Oh, hi. I have a question regarding my garden.
Okay.
Last year, I decided to make a small vegetable patch, and I added some, bag compost and what have you, and scattered some seeds for some vegetables, like lettuce. They came up, and within a week, all the teeny seedlings that were there were just all chewed up, but none of them survived. I wonder, is there something in the soil itself, like the insect or worms or caterpillar that ate them, and what can I use to control things that are in the soil?
Okay, so you seeded in lettuce, and lettuce seedlings, and all seedlings in general, are delicate little babies. And when they are just coming up and have their first two or three leaves, they are really delicate little tiny babies. And if they get fed on by insects, it can really wreck them at that point in their life. If you get them up and they're 6, 8, 10 inches tall and lots of leaves, then they get fed on a little, it doesn't hurt them that much. But when they're little tiny seedlings, they can really get trashed very easily with insect infestation. I would bet you had one of the sucking insects that's not soil-borne. There are some soil-borne insects that will, like grubs, the larva can be in the soil, like cutworm.
Right.
That could be a problem. It's hard to say what it was specifically because we don't have the plants are long gone. And it's hard to identify the pest at this point in time.
Well, actually, they started turning yellow before they got their second leaf, and then I looked closer and the tops were, eaten off.
Well,
in broad patches.
Yeah, you probably got attacked by an insect. The thing about insects is you've got to catch it. You've got to find it in order to know exactly what it is. A lot of times you'll see chewing. You don't know if it was a beetle or a caterpillar. So you don't know if you should use BT or maybe spinosad. Well, what you might want to do, since you had, it didn't work out so good for you. There, you can buy them in pony packs and get them larger instead of seeding in, but I'm a big proponent of seeding in. I love seeding in. But you've got to monitor it quickly. And so you've got to try and catch, find out what's going on right away when you see damage. But you might want to use a preventative spray of spinosad or hit them with soapy water once or twice when they're little. As soon as they come up, hit them with a little soapy water. Maybe do that a couple times during the week. You got to get them up and healthy. If they turned yellow on you, did you use a pre-plant fertilizer?
No, I just have to compost.
That's a really a very good thing to do is when you turn your soil, you add organic matter like compost, which was really excellent thing to do. You also want to add a little bit of a pre-plant fertilizer so you have sufficient nitrogen in the soil that you get a good takeoff. The plants are vigorous and growing, you know, really strongly right off the bat. If they went yellow on you, you might have had a, you know, what type of amendment did you use?
What type of what?
You used a compost or a bagged material?
Right.
Do you remember what it was?
No.
Okay. The thing about adding organic matter to the soil is if you add a very woody mix to the soil, something with a lot of wood chip in it, it will lock up all the nitrogen in the soil for about 2 weeks, up to 3 or 4 weeks even, depending on how much wood is in the mix. So if you get a very inexpensive bag of compost, often when you open that up, look at it, it's got a lot of wood chip in it. Now it's really important you add some nitrogen to the soil. Or after you mix it into the soil, you need to wait about 2 weeks before you plant your plants. I did it, I speak from experience.
Oh.
I had a very woody compost that I got, and I mixed a lot into the soil. And I planted tomatoes and eggplant and pepper. They all turned bright yellow. I started pouring nitrogen on them. Slowly, the peppers and the tomatoes greened up and came back. The eggplants were stunted for the whole season. They never recovered from that nitrogen deficiency when they were little tiny, you know, seedlings. So always use a pre-plant fertilizer. Now, if you want to be organic, you're going to want to use something like cottonseed meal or blood meal. Or, you know, the old formula was 4 parts cottonseed meal to 1 part blood meal. If you're not wedded to being organic, you can go get any kind of fertilizer, follow the label, broadcast it in, turn it in a little bit, water it in a little bit, and then put your seedlings in, or broadcast your seed, or put out your pony packs, or however you plant. I love seeding. Seeding in is my, I love to grow from seed. And lettuce is easy to grow from seed.
Well, sometimes you can't get, you like a certain type of vegetable.
Oh, absolutely. If you go from seed, that opens up your palette of plant material to almost anything. You can order it online. There's all the catalogs. There's all these interesting varieties you can select from. If you just go down to Home Depot or Lowe's or Osh or wherever your garden, local garden center, you're pretty much limited to whatever they have on the shelf.
Right.
They might have some interesting varieties, but it's going to be a limited palette, not the expansive palette you have available.
So you think what I had was a chewing insect, and I should have used some sort of soap once they came up?
Well, if you suspect chewing, if you see the leaves are chewed on and the edges are scalloped, then you want to use spinosad. If you see the sucking insects, you should be able to see them right there because they don't leave. They're going to be there always. They don't walk around and they don't leave the plant. Then you can use oils and soaps. But you got to inspect them right away. As soon as the seedlings come up, be out there checking them every day until they get up and they're established. Now they're 3 inches, 6 inches tall, and they're established. They got their roots out there. And make sure your seedlings don't dry out. The other problem with seedlings is if you let them dry out for a day or two, that can also trash them. They cannot go dry.
Well, these just barely came up, and they just had their first, you know, their little teeny little leaves. They didn't even come out with their first primary, and they just, the whole thing was just gone.
Well, you know, try the pre-plant fertilizer. You know, don't give up. I'm sure you can have success with, you know, gardening is a learning experience.
Right.
So
now, I have another question. I grew some peppers and what have you in the ground. So they didn't do too well, and I guess, like you said, it didn't put any nitrogen in it for them. But do you advocate the soilless mix to grow them in pots?
Well, if you grow them in pots, I would use a potting mix. And that's not really soilless. Soilless would be like a hydroponic system with a wick and a water system. But if you grow them in pots, I would definitely use a potting soil that's, you know, in bags. You don't want to use bulk soil. You don't want to just dig soil out of your backyard and put it in a pot. It doesn't work well at all.
Well, it has a lot of weed seeds in it, and it just comes right up.
Yeah, you might, you know, if you just use soil, you're going to get weeds coming up in your pot. You're probably going to get weeds in your pot anyway because the seeds drift in and land in the pot. But if you use a, the thing about pots is you've got to have excellent drainage in pots.
Right.
So you have to use a potting mix. And you shouldn't use bulk soil that you dig out of your garden. The advantage to using potting mixes is there'll already be a lot of nitrogen in the bag. The various manufacturers add fertilizer to those mixes. And they have excellent drainage. They'll be mixed with things like perlite or vermiculite. They'll be high in organic matter. They're really excellent to use. And then you can use 5-gallon pots or 15-gallon pots. And a lot of people have limited space, don't have a lot of open soil in their backyard. They might have enough full sun. The other key element for you is how much full sun you had. Your vegetables need to get full sun pretty much all day.
Yeah, they do.
Oh, good. Then you have... Another thing that'll help you is using raised beds.
Using what?
Raised beds.
Oh, yeah.
You take a 2x6 or some type of a plank or board, and you build a little rectangular box, and you elevate the soil level like 3 to 6 inches. And then you can really mix in a lot of organic matter. The general recommendation is you put down like 4 inches of compost, turn it into a depth of 4 inches, you end up with 8 inches of 50-50, 50% compost, 50% soil, a really loose soil where roots will grow easily, high organic matter, and you still want to add a little pre-plant fertilizer and make, and then after about a month, you're going to want to come back and give them a little more fertilizer. Mm. You know, nitrogen is highly soluble. It's almost always deficient in the soil.
All right.
The other is potassium and phosphorus. You know, it's NPK on the fertilizer bag. So phosphorus and potassium are rarely deficient, although they're always thrown into the fertilizer bag. I mean, it's always part of the fertilizer. But nitrogen, you see, is soluble, and it leaches out of the soil during the winter rains. The plants use it up, and so you almost always need to add a nitrogen fertilizer. Cottonseed meal is excellent.
How about growing melons or what have you in pots? Is that a pain?
I like to grow them right in the ground on mounds, but you could grow them in pots. You're just going to have to come up with a way to support the melons themselves. So, or if it could spill out and get onto the ground, then the melons could be there. But the melons are kind of heavy. I've seen a lot of people grow like cucumbers on a trellis, and then they take stockings and put the cucumbers in the stocking and tie it onto the trellis to support the cucumber. So you'd have to do something similar to support the melons, whether you're growing cantaloupes or muskmelon. It'd be very hard to grow watermelon in a pot because it really needs to be sitting on the ground. They get heavy and they're going to tear off the plant if they're not supported.
All right. I'll give it a try this year.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
My pleasure. Thank you
Bye-bye.
For calling in.
All right. Bye.
So, you know, in fact, that reminds me that just about a week or two ago, I was at an organic nursery, and last fall they had a big crop failure with most of their lettuce seedlings. And when I went to look at them, they showed a lot of insect feeding damage. And that's the key, is those little tiny seedlings are so delicate that any adverse impacts to them at that stage can often stunt them or make them do quite poorly. And seedlings, if they dry out for a day or two, they can just die. So seedlings are fun. I love to grow a seed, but when they're little, you gotta really monitor them on a daily basis. Got to make sure that, and almost all, you know, if you've got them in 4-inch pots, you may be watering that pot every other day. And of course, once it comes up in the 4-inch pot and gets to, you know, it roots out and it's filled the pot with roots, you don't want to wait till it's circling the pot with roots. As soon as it fills the pot with roots, get it in the ground or get it into a bigger pot. Depends on how you seed it in. So let's go on to a couple more products. We talked about diazinon that has been pulled. Now, this is a product that's been in my garage probably for decades. I didn't buy it. You buy a house, people leave stuff behind in the garage, and go through the garage and see what you got. I think there's more toxic materials in people's garages across California than in toxic landfills. So this is called 7. This is a garden dust. You dust this on to things like rose bushes or whatever you want to kill. 7 is a carbamate. You know, the two broad groups of insecticides, and there's all sorts of them, I don't want to simplify it too much, but there are the coal restorase inhibitors like diazinon, myalthion, and orthine, And then there were the carbamates, and 7 is a carbamate. It's also a cholerestase inhibitor, but a different chemistry, not the same chemistry as the but so anyway, it's a carbamate. 7 is still available. You can still buy it. It's a broad spectrum insecticide. The kind of thing you would reach for if you had a scale insect infestation and you couldn't control it, or if you had a white fly infestation and the oils and soaps and the pyrethrins just weren't doing it, then you'd finally say, you know, I got to control this or give up on that plant. And white flies can be devastating to certain crops, especially lettuce, because they are major vectors of viruses into lettuce. So you want to control white flies if you get them on lettuce, especially. But this is 7 Garden Dust. And it's just something that was in my garage when I bought my house. And I can tell you, it's probably just as active today as it was when it was purchased probably several decades ago. If you don't want this stuff, if you're not going to use it, take it to a hazardous waste roundup. It's free. You can get rid of paint thinner and paints and oil and old pesticides that you don't want. Look on the internet for your neighborhood or check with your, depending on what city you live in, check with your city government. These hazardous waste roundups are usually run by the Los Angeles County Fire Department Hazardous Waste Materials Unit. You pull in, they don't even let you out of your car. You give them your keys, they open your trunk, they take everything out, they close your trunk, they give you back your keys, and off you go. You can get rid of TVs, computers, everything. So if you've got stuff like this that you're not going to use and you want to get rid of it, take it to a hazardous waste roundup. Don't put it in the trash. That's not the right place for it. Now, let's talk a little bit about systemic insecticides and imidacloprid and the neonicotinoids. Often you can have very large trees, 50 to 75 foot trees, that can get infested with sucking insects. Sucking insects drip honeydew. One of the ways you know you have sucking insects is the lower leaves get covered with this sticky honeydew that drips off the rear ends of aphids and mealybugs and scale and all those kind of insects. And then you get black mold growing in that sugary, sweet, sticky stuff. And that's so sooty mold. So you know you've got this infestation in this huge tree that you can't possibly spray. You could hire someone to spray it. It costs you $150, $200. And they spray it, but you spray a 75-foot tree, that spray is going to cover every house for 100 or 200 feet. So not a great idea, but there are systemics, and a lot of people don't like them, but this is Bayer Advanced Garden Tree and Shrub. Oh, got the wrong one. This is Bayer Advanced Garden Tree and Shrub. Oop, it's open. I don't want it to be open. So this is actually empty. So let's just put this one over here. The active ingredient is called imidacloprid. It's what you call a neonicotinoid, which means it has the same active or same mode of action as nicotine. Now, nicotine was used in a lot of insecticides, but today is banned. It's not used in any insecticides anymore. Apparently, it's too toxic. You can poison yourself with cigarettes, but you can't kill your insects in your backyard with it. Well, actually, you can. If you want to take tobacco and soak it in water, the nicotine will come out into the water, and then spray your plants with that, and you'll kill your insects. And you might consider that to be fairly organic because it's natural. Tobacco's a plant, and you're just extracting a little nicotine out of a cigarette or loose tobacco, and then, you know, put it in a bucket of water and let it sit there overnight, and then spray that water on your plants. It'll probably kill the insects. But you can't buy any nicotine-based insecticides anymore. They're all gone. They're all withdrawn from the market. And Bayer came out with new chemistry, the neonicotinoids, and imidacloprid is one of them. And if you look at the active ingredient, let me see if I can find it on here. It says active ingredient, imidacloprid, 1.47%. If you hire someone to use to treat your tree, they'll use a label called Merit rather than this. This is the homeowner packaging. You drench the soil. You mix this with water. You water the tree with it. It takes it up. It takes up to 3 months to get up into a large tree, a 50 to 75 foot tree, and it will control the insects on that tree for up to 12 months. So once in the spring, usually late February, early March, is the best time to apply this. We have some trees that have been getting a lot of insect pests. Tipuanu trees, which are large trees, are getting a Tipuanu psyllid. And I didn't talk much about the psyllids. Psyllid is another sucking insect. And then we've got the eucalyptus trees. Some of the eucalyptus have red gum lerp psyllid. The lemon gums have a spotted gum lerp psyllid. These trees, it's just too big to spray. So you can put this on it, it'll control it for 12 months. Your rose bushes, you can put it on your rose bushes, it'll control all the insects on your rose bushes for 12 months. It's not organic, but it's fairly low toxicity. It's not that bad. It's not really high toxicity like some of the old chemistries, but it is controversial because people are blaming the bee kills on imidacloprid. And I disagree with that conclusion for a variety of reasons. But there is a phenomenon called colony collapse disorder, and that's where bees just go off out of the colony in the morning and then don't come back. They have poor flight, they lose their ability to navigate, they are strongly attracted to water. That's kind of and it usually happens more in the winter than it happens in the summer. And this is a big, big issue, because there's been a lot of bee die-offs across North America, mostly beekeepers, not so much feral colonies, but I think it's mostly in controlled hives, in boxes. So that's called colony collapse disorder. And a lot of people want to blame it solely on imidacloprid, but that doesn't make a whole lot of sense, because the varroa mite is devastating to bees and was introduced into Florida, 20, 30 years ago. And within a year, it spread across all of North America, because they pick up bees and put them on trucks and drive them all the way across the country. So the bee industry distributed the varroa mite very efficiently. Plus the bees are getting viruses vectored by the varroa mite. The viruses are devastating to these bees, particularly the deformed wing virus. But there are literally dozens and dozens of viruses they found in bees. And as you move them from one part of the country to the next, you're going to expose them to multiple viruses at these different locations. So by the time you drive your bees from Florida to Oklahoma, all the stops in between, and you get to California, you've picked up a lot of viruses in your bees. They are handling it pretty well in the bee industry, a variety of ways to handle it. One is to requeen your hives very rapidly, but I'm digressing about IPM. But IPM should also take into account bees. If you're spraying to control an insect, you don't want to kill all the bees in your tree because they're there pollinating your crop, and you're going to get a reduced yield if you kill the bees. So IPM takes into account bees. So if you're going to spray, you're going to spray after dusk. The bees all go home to the hive at the end of the day. They don't fly at night. So you spray after the bees have left. You use pesticides that have the least effect on bees. You oils and soaps. If they're going to have very little effect on bees if the bees aren't in the tree when you're spraying. So you have to take into account your bees. But this is Bayer Advanced Garden Tree and Shrub. The active ingredient is imidacloprid. It is a systemic insecticide that you apply as a root drench. It can be sprayed on the foliage, where it will absorb into the foliage and last for about 30 days. It does not last as long when applied as a foliar spray. There's another one, which is called Orthene, which also is a systemic insecticide, but it's normally applied as a foliar spray that lasts 30 days. I cannot use Orthene because the smell is horrendous, and it makes me want to throw up. I cannot take the smell of Orthene. I had a can of Orthene in my garage, never opened the can, but the smell from that can permeated my whole garage. I couldn't even go in the garage. So I had to get rid of it. I took it to a hazardous waste roundup. So that's imidacloprid. Now, imidacloprid is sold under a variety of, this is Bayer Advanced Garden Rose and Flower Care. And this is imidacloprid 0.15%. So this is much weaker solution of imidacloprid, but this is meant for roses and flowers. Now, imidacloprid is also labeled under the name Admire for ag production. And it's used in citrus, grape, vegetables. It's used extensively. And that's one of the reasons they blame the bee problem on imidacloprid, because it is used pretty extensively in agriculture. They banned imidacloprid in France because they're worried about the bees, but they didn't get rid of colony collapse disorder. And they do use imidacloprid in Australia widely, but they don't have colony collapse disorder. So blaming colony collapse disorder on imidacloprid doesn't seem to make a whole lot of sense when the facts contradict that. Now let's take a look at another thing, Roundup. Roundup, of course, is an herbicide. It's used extensively to control herbaceous weeds. You have to use it a little higher concentration to kill shrubs like poison ivy or some type of woody shrub that you don't want to grow, you want to just kill it. You don't want to try and pull out poison ivy. A lot of people call me up. They have poison oak, I should say, not poison ivy. We have poison oak in California. So they have poison oak. They might live in Sierra Madre or La Cañada or Altadena. They're up against the chaparral. And they have poison oak growing on their property. They want to get rid of it. You don't want to go out there and pull it up because you're going to get blistered skin. You're going to get the rash. I have a lot of experience with that. Let me tell you, it's not pleasant. And so you're going to want to spray that. You can use Roundup. It'll knock off the leaves, but you probably have to use a stronger concentration or even multiple applications to kill woody shrubs with Roundup. Ortho Brush Be Gone has the active ingredient is triclopyr, and that works better on woody shrubs and trees. So, and if you have invasive tree species coming up in a vacant lot, you might want to use something like that rather than... this other one here is called Hot Shot Roach Killing Powder. This is actually boric acid. And it is it's boric acid, 99%. This is boric acid. I use this to kill ants. I don't dust it around my house because boric acid, everyone loves, all the organic people, all the soft pesticide people love boric acid. And I like it too. But I don't dust my whole house with it. I mix boric acid with sugar water and use that to bait for ants. And that's how you want to do ants. Ants have a collective stomach the workers go out and collect the food, bring it back to the colony, and regurgitate the food. So whatever the workers eat, the colony eats. So you give them a low dose of a toxin with something they want to eat, like sugar water. The sugar is the bait, the water is the carrier, and the boric acid is the toxicant, or the toxic material. So I use about a tablespoon per cup of water, and I use a lot of sugar in that cup of water to make it almost syrupy. And then I'll heat it up a little bit to dissolve the sugar in the boric acid. You don't want to go over 1% boric acid. If you go over 1% boric acid, the workers that collect it will be killed before they get back to the colony. So you want to give them a low dose that they can collect it, return, share it, and you're going to kill the colony. It's very good, very effective way to suppress and control Argentine ant and other ants as well. But Argentine ant's the most common one you see come in your house, the little black ones. And Argentine ants farm all these sucking insects in your garden. So if you're trying to control scale or aphids or mealybug, you usually also have to control the ants because the ants protect them. Now I've got another video clip. It's IPM in agriculture. And let's see here. You know what? I've got a shorter one, late blight on potato. And late blight is a really interesting a disease. It was really the birth of plant pathology in the mid-1800s. Late blight was the disease that wiped out potatoes in Ireland in 1845 to 1848. And let's go to that video right now on identifying late blight of potato.
In front of a row that's been devastated by a serious fungal disease called late blight. In 2009, we've had quite a few cases of late blight in gardens in the mid-Atlantic area. This is a disease that affects tomato and potato. The disease came up on transplants that were grown in the south this spring. The plants were distributed through stores throughout the mid-Atlantic, and unfortunately, people that planted infected plants often began to see these serious symptoms in their garden. The only solution for late blight in a garden is to pull up the plants, put them in a trash bag, tie off the bag, let it sit out in the sun for a while, a couple of days, and then put that bag out for the trash pickup so it can go to the landfill. Now I'm going to show you just a couple of the symptoms that will kind of let you know whether or not you have late blight. With a lot of tomato diseases that get on the leaves, you'll see little spots beginning on the lower leaves, little brown spots. With late blight, the entire leaf will be blighted. It'll turn brown and die. If it's wet outside, the leaf will look soft, and when it dries out, it'll just dry and die. But that's very different than our other diseases. Another key symptom are these brown spots on the stems of the plants. We wouldn't normally see that with other tomato diseases. And the third major symptom are these significant spots on the fruits themselves. So if you put these three together, the leaf, the stem, the fruit, and you feel like you've got late blight, you need to pull those plants out. We have a lot of good information and pictures up on our Grow It, Eat It website.
A nice little clip on late blight, and I wanted to run it before the end of the show. We're coming to the end of our show now today, and I wanted to just mention late blight of potato. It is a unique disease. It only goes to tomatoes and potatoes. It is caused by a water mold called Phytophthora infestans. Phytophthora is a genus with about 100 species. In 1845, it rained constantly in Ireland, and they were growing a highly susceptible variety of potato. So late blight swept through the potatoes and destroyed them, and just it turns them to mush within a week or two after, you know, and the wind. What happens is this fungus-like organism, it's really parasitic algae, infects the plant. On the backs of the leaves, it makes these sporangia, or these sacs, that break off in the wind and the rain. And then they splash onto another leaf. When they get there, they release swimming spores called zoospores that swim on the surface of the leaf in the water and infect that leaf. And then it infects the, and then it starts coming out the bottom of the leaf again, and then it splashes onto more leaves. And so it'll start on one plant, and then it'll splash onto more plants, and in relatively short time, a few weeks, you can have an acre of potatoes turned into black mush. And so that's what happened in Ireland for 3 years in a row. The potatoes failed, and that's what the poor, the peasants, or the land locked, the term I want, they didn't own any land. They were like indentured. They were almost, you know, almost to the level of being slaves. And so they had nothing to eat. And 1 million people starved to death, and 1 million people immigrated out of Ireland. It was a world-changing event, the Irish potato famine. So how do you deal with that today? Resistant varieties, weather prediction models that tell you when to spray, and then a very effective spray is for late blight of potato. That it wasn't even diagnosed as the cause until the 1870s, even though the epidemic started then. Well, we've run out of time. This has been a very fun show to give today because we get to go through all these products. I want to thank the crew in the room for coming in on Sunday and helping put on the show and all their hard work. We'll be back next week, and I'm not sure what we're going to talk about, but I have 15 seconds to tell you. But we'll be back next Sunday. And we'll talk more about your garden. Until then, I want to wish you happy gardening. Thank everyone who called in, and have a wonderful day, and enjoy the Super Bowl. Take care.